G'day and welcome back to Buildsum, and this is the 27th presentation on the timber framing code, and this one is going to be on joists. So the rules associated with joists are 4.2.2 and 4.3.2, and the table that we need for this particular example is table 6. Let's have a look at those in a bit more detail. So rule 4.2.2 says that joists shall be laid with their top surfaces level to receive flooring. The underside of joists having minor excesses shall be notched over bearers in order to bring them to the required level. Packing of joists having minor deficiencies in depth may be utilised, providing the packing is fixed and is of corrosion resistant and incompressible material over the full area of contact. Now, while packing of joists is permitted, it's not a usual practice. Normally try and pack just under the bearers if you can get away with it. The spacing of joists shall be determined by the span capacity of the flooring. So you have to have a look at what flooring you're going to use to work out how far apart you're going to put your joists. And additional single or double joists shall be provided where required to support load-bearing walls parallel to the joists. Joists having a minor spring within allowable limits shall be laid as to allow straightening under loading, regardless of their length. If the joists are partially cut over supports to correct bow, they shall be deemed to be supported at two points only, so they become a single span rather than a continuous span. Where cuts are used to correct bow or spring, they shall be located centrally over the support so that each side of the cut section is adequately supported. Joints in joists shall be made only over bearers or supports. Joists joined over a bearer support shall have a minimum 30mm bearing for each joist, and joints in joists that are required to be in line, for example supporting wall plates or fitting floors, shall be butted or scarved, but shall not be lapped. Location of the joists for a filled floor, or it's also called a fitted floor, for flooring that abuts wall plates, a pair of joists shall be provided under each wall that is parallel to the direction of the joist, and these joists shall be placed to provide solid bearing and fixing for the bottom wall plate and to project no less than 12mm to give support for fixing of the flooring. Platform flooring, where flooring is continuous under the wall plates, joists shall be provided directly under all load-bearing walls parallel to the joists. A single joist only required under external non-load-bearing walls. The joists not required under internal non-load-bearing walls except as required to support flooring. So basically what that means is under all our load-bearing walls we need to have two joists. If you've got a cut-in floor where the walls are sitting directly onto your joists, then you need to have two joists under each wall that run parallel to the joists. For a platform floor, for your external walls that run parallel, you have to have two joists. For a load-bearing wall that runs parallel with the joists, you have to have a joist underneath the wall, and there's no need for a joist underneath an internal non-load-bearing wall. For deep joists, where the depth of the floor joist is equal to or exceeds four times the depth of the joist, the joists shall be restrained at their supports with either a continuous trimming joist provided to the ends of the joist above external bearers, so like a block, or you can also use solid blocking, herringbone striding between the outer pairs of joists and the inner intermediate pairs at not more than 800 centres. And if you have a look at my videos on deep joists, you'll see what I mean by those, and I'll put a link in the description. Rule 4.3.2 says that the size of the floor joist shall be determined from Table 6 of the supplements. For the size of joists for decks located more than a metre above the ground floor, above the ground, shall be determined from Table 50 of the supplements. The floor joist supporting floor loads only. Floor joists may cantilever up to 25% of the allowable span, provided the minimum back span is at least twice the cantilever distance. So the preliminary calcs for this exercise, my roof load width is 1800, and I'm going to again assume that it's 1800 between my bearers. So they're the numbers we're going to use. So we can go to the table. So we've got sheet roof, and I'm going to look at a continuous span. My roof load width was 1800, so I have to go to the 4500 column again and come down here till I find something bigger than 18. And there we go, there, 2 meters. So I can use the 120 by 45. However, with my efficiency rule, I would rather use the 140 by 35 for my joists. So there you go, we have rule 4.2.2 and 4.3.2, that should be, and table 6, and 140 by 35 joists is what we're going to use.